very sight and this very place. We stood here and went through this ceremony, and it's an absolute great privilege for me to ask those people who are termed plank owners of this vessel, who stood here exactly 50 years ago, almost to the hour, to stand up and be recognized. Please do.
I felt a real privilege to serve aboard a ship that I had helped build. I was employed by the Norfolk Navy Yard early in 1942, and I happened to be one of the lucky fellows to be aboard when it was launched. It made me feel proud to be a part of the ship there that was going to help defend our country.
Each time we prepared coffee, it was four coppers like this, each containing 80 gallons, and for a total of 320 gallons. On Thanksgiving and Christmas, I remember this day, I worked as a night cook, and I prepared 2,000 pounds of turkey per meal.
On the other side of the galley here, they had a bakery shop. They baked their own bread. They baked biscuits for breakfast a lot of times, and you always had bread that was baked here because you had no other way of getting it. You was in a storm, in a typhoon in 1944. You set your tray down, but you have to hold the table and hold your thumb in your tray to keep your tray from sliding all over and losing everything you got. And you'll rock back and forth as you eat. As you go back, and as you come back, you'll take another bite. You had to get in sequence with the roll of the ship. About 48 years ago, I had tonsillitis, and they performed a tonsillectomy on me here in this sick bay. But you didn't have no pretty nurses. All you had was these old pharmacist mates.
I was a seaman first class in the L Division, which was the lookout division for the Alabama. Our station was up there, right below the searchlight platform. You have this first-class view of everything going on. So we've seen ships massed on the horizon. We look for airplanes.
That was my living quarters right in there. That was 10th Division in there. And when general quarters blew, you had 3 minutes to get from there down there to that 40 millimeter. And a lot of times, the Japs would be coming in before we got there.
We went to general quarters one time, and I came up there stark naked. I had been caught in the shower, so I had my clothes in my hand. But when we went to general quarters, irrespective of your condition, you went.
The first thing, you put your headphones on, turn your water jackets on, and whenever personnel was reported, Hill, the pointer, Hatley was a trainer, your first four loaders and your first second loaders, then you checked your ammunition handlers. When the gun was manned, he reported to Sky Control that Quad 5 was manned and ready.
The gun captain would give me command to commence firing, and I would mash the pedal.
When the Japs would come in at us, they'd come at us all angles, skipping the ocean line, and also they get up in them clouds where you couldn't see them and dive down on you.
I would look through crosshair here. Of course, you had to lead, let the plane run into the ammunition. You had to fire ahead of the plane, let the plane run into it.
All the kamikazes were coming in, and they were shot down, they hit the water, they would disintegrate, they'd go flipping over like that.
And one plane was coming from the bow to the stern, he was out. And we was at general quarters, and they asked to commence firing, and we did, and we could see chunks of fire coming out of the fuselage.
We had to lower our our guns so low when the Japs were coming in skimming the ocean line that the guy lowered the turret too far, and that's where the hole got there when the shells went right through the splinter shield.
I was a gunner's mate, second class on USS Alabama, Mon 2, 5-inch 38. It started in the lower ammunition room where all the ammunition was stored. And when they needed ammunition up in the upper handling room below the gun mounts, they would send them up by conveyor belts, the projectiles and the powder.
This area feed the ammunition up to the guns themselves.
And the powder was in casings, brass casings about 3 foot long.
Charge of powder come up through this hose right here when they raided the bar. They kept us supplied the whole time, but every time you take a charge of powder out of here and loading this gun here just like this right here, and we had another gunner right in front of us here, you pulling your projectile out of the hose there. That right there is a gun control tower, V5-inch 38. We had our gunnery officer right in there, and he gave us orders there just like we had an air attack coming in or something. Stand by, ready, all guns. Answer in, answer in. Commence firing. Ready on one, sir. Fire one. Keep right on firing. This here's a continuous fire. We just keep reporting out there. Coming out. Wham, 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 wham.
This is the conning tower of the main navigation bridge. These are periscopes, the battle periscopes for the captain to operate during the shore bombardments or whatever battle's going on. This is where you steered from. These are the compass repeaters from the main, from the central station, the main compass below. Engine order telegraph gave orders to the engine room back or go forward.
When they ring from topside from the bridge, it registers here. This is your ahead throttle. You open that up when you want steam. You get steam from number one boiler room. And if you want to go astern, if you want to go backwards, you have to shut this throttle off and open this one to go astern, to go back. We had 600 pounds of steam, superheated, 750 degrees. The steam is forced right into the turbines. If one of these steam lines broke, if you got hit by a plane or a bomb or something, you never got out of the engine room. It cut you right in half.
This is the Admiral's plotting room.
They got the same information that the bridge got when he was on board.
These are his plotting tables. He had three of them.
During battle, while they could plot planes or ships or whatever they're going on.
The information was gathered by the crew and its gun director through optical instruments or radar, was transmitted to the plotting room to a computer in the plotting room.
This information is established into the main battery computer system.
The computer analyzed the information, corrections were added to it, dead time for loading the guns, wind speed, wind direction, ship movement, and the roll and pitch of the ship that was stabilized. The ship moving would move around, but the guns would stay steady, regardless whether she pitched, yawed, or rolled. It was very efficient. It was really good.
To get powder to the guns, we bring it from the magazines, which are external to the turret, through a bronze scuttle. When a full charge is loaded, six bags being a full charge, the door to the powder hoist is opened, the bags roll in, the door closes, and the hoist raises them to the gun chamber. We're now on the upper projectile deck of turret 2 on the USS Alabama. The projectile hoist has a pawl that drops down under the projectile and raises it through a tube up to the gun compartment, where it is placed on a rammer tray and rammed into the breech of the gun ahead of the powder. The breech is swung shut, a primer is inserted, and the gun is ready to fire. Once on target, we can achieve a fire rate of one salvo every 30 seconds. This is throwing a 2,700-pound projectile 22 miles. Alabama is very fortunate in having never suffered any enemy damage, although we had been in many, many engagements.
This is my copy of the USS Alabama War Diary, and on August 15, 1945, I sat at this desk and wrote this little note. It says, "Today, Wednesday, August 15, 1945, the Japanese have accepted our surrender terms. I can't express the happiness and rejoicing throughout the ship. It's surely a day to remember. We all thank God for our safety."
And God, the good Lord, protected all of us on that ship.
Serving on this ship, I think, was one of the greatest experiences of my life.
It was the mighty A. Somebody in some PR department called it Lucky A. We weren't lucky, we were good.
USS Alabama crew members, you have felt this ship's decks roll with the sea. You have smelled bread baking in her ovens. You have heard the waves crashing against her bow. You have given this ship her life. And this ship, in turn, has given you her steel.
enemy shore off Korea. Those mountains are alive with guns, ammunition, and supplies on their way to the communist front. Our ship is here to see they don't arrive. In the moment before the big guns start firing, there's always a certain tenseness, reflected in the quiet attitudes of the men at general quarters. With the guns moving into firing position, I take my station on the bridge, feeling, as every battleship captain at times like this, the responsibility of command. For this is a war in which every broadside must count. It's when the guns are firing efficiently, like this, that you can be proud of your crew down below. It takes men with Navy know-how in the turrets to feed those big guns, men who've learned their job through long hours of training and hard work. Coordination and teamwork move the shells smoothly into position.
Fire up, right. Auto weapon. Fire up, right. Stand by. Stand by.
And that's TNT in powder bags, which must be handled delicately and surely. It takes six of those charges to hurl a shell deep down the communist throat. Guns must be aimed properly, too. For this job, my officers are at work in the main battery plot. These gunnery officers are tackling the fire control problem of the action we call interdiction, the destruction of enemy supply lines and rear area facilities.
Right, 217.
Our mission off Korea. To halt the flow of supplies which keep the communist armies fed and equipped. Mostly, we concentrate on the coastline railways, bridges, supply dumps, and depots. But we can shell targets as far as 20 miles inland when necessary, and planes off our carriers can take care of targets farther inland. In emergency, our ship has been put to work in shore bombardment. My men like the job. They call it exporting steel to some tough customers. I call it making a battleship captain feel pride in his command. But elsewhere at sea, we're still engaged in our traditional job with the fleet. The floating fortress, which provides anti-aircraft and heavy gun protection for the carriers and smaller ships, and forms a nucleus for offensive action when required. There's another side to this ship when the guns are stilled and the battle's over for a while. That's when she comes to mean something more than a fortress. Something a lot more personal to her men aboard. Something all hands can call home. Of course, you've got to keep a home clean. And here are some of my boys doing homework. To make the varsity on this ship, you have to be a member of the scrub team. Cleanliness is a personal thing, too. And we hold inspections often enough to keep the ship and her crew in trim. Tons of clothes arrive in the ship's laundry during the year. Dungarees and whites receive the full treatment in the tubs until they're hauled out limp but clean. What makes a ship happy? Part of the answer is having all the facilities of a hometown, including a well-equipped bakery. It takes 850 loaves of bread a day to feed our crew of 2,700 men. But the specialty of any bakery is their cake. And here, a baker cuts his masterpiece into enough small pieces to satisfy the crew. Of course, life isn't all cake, and neither is Navy chow. What this cook is cutting, in case landlubbers don't recognize it, is beef. Good, juicy, inch-thick steaks. Hungry? The steaks won't be ready until tomorrow, but meanwhile, there's good news on the grill. Sizzling ham. Tastes as good as it looks, and the men are happy to stand in line to prove it. Chow down, fore and aft. And the crew starts attacking that chow with the zest it deserves. In another compartment, the Marines aboard are having a birthday celebration. The Admiral is on hand to join in the festivities. But the high point of the affair seems to be the dessert. Man, that's real eating. On a ship as on shore, you can't keep up with the world without a newspaper. We publish our own in the print shop and get to read it after the editors finish admiring their own work. There's a ship service where you can buy everything from watches to soap. Not as big as the corner drugstore, but just as well supplied for Navy needs. At the ice cream fountain, the star attraction is the Big Dipper, and the crew seems to appreciate it. Medicine for all the crew's ills comes from this compartment, the pharmacy. The formula this hospital corpsman is mixing looks rather mysterious. In another medical compartment, our eye, ear, nose, and throat specialist looks a little mysterious himself. Skilled Navy doctors are on board with modern surgical equipment to handle any emergency in the operating room. But for some of the sheiks of the crew, the real emergencies happen in the barbershop, where a short clip can be the unkindest cut of all. The mail room is the most popular spot in the ship. By this time, most of the crew have learned that the only way to earn their letter is to write one. And these are going out by air. A waiting helicopter is ready to start them on the first lap of their journey across half the world. Below decks, the activity of this mighty ship is ceaseless. In the engine room, the black gang is on the job, keeping the propellers in motion. The machine shop is the mechanical repair center of the ship. A combination of skilled hands and modern equipment grinds, molds, and refits gears for use. The electrical shop is the maintenance center for the miles of wire on a battleship. Here, an electrician rewinds just a few feet of it. Mechanical spare parts for almost any emergency line the shelves of this shop, including pipe fittings, bolts, shackles, and grinding stones. If you want to get the word, this is the place to go. In fact, the ship's library stocks millions of them, written by the world's finest authors. This man high up the coast of Korea takes a moment off to read about more glamorous regions down under. Sooner or later, almost every man needs legal advice of one sort or another. A legal officer is aboard to give expert advice and aid when needed. In this shop are the men who keep the Navy from coming apart at the seams. A skillful use of needle and thread, applied with modern sewing machines, keeps uniforms as good as new. Shoes take a beating on the spacious decks of a battleship, and sooner or later, they all end up in the cobbler's shop for repairs. Among other qualifications, a cobbler has to like the taste of nails. So another day off the enemy coast of Korea has passed. Our ship has grown one day older, and the crew and myself one day wiser in the ways of battle in these far eastern waters. And now, at sunset, one of my men steps up to make an announcement.
Now hear this. All hands silence for sunset prayer.
This is Chaplain Kapelsinski with the sunset prayer.
Oh my God, as we prepare for rest tonight, we place our souls into thy hands, giving thee again our last thoughts of this busy fighting day. We desire that you always occupy the first and main place in our lives. We thank thee for thy loving care and protection during this day of battle. Increase in us, O Lord, faithfulness to our duties, so that our preparedness may keep our country safe. Be with us when we are lonely and miss the dear ones back home. Be with them as thou art with us. Help us to keep our hearts pure and our hands clean. Protect us in the hour of danger, and be thou our shield and defender. Cause war to cease, we pray. And when peace comes, may we do our part in the building of a new and better world in which love shall prevail and the Spirit of Christ cover the earth. May it be thy will to grant us an early peace. Amen.
So dawn breaks again in these waters, and briefly in the morning quiet, a kind of peace seems to reign. Yet those of us aboard this ship, captain and crew, know the day may bring battle and turmoil, along with its daily ration of work, laughter, and just plain living. When it does, we'll be ready. For this is the life you ask for when you serve aboard a battleship, floating fortress of the nation's fleet.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we return you in time to this day. 50 years ago, our cast: Rear Admiral Felix Gygax, Commandant of the Norfolk Navy Yard, will be portrayed by Captain George Kreitmeier, U.S. Coast Guard retired, currently with the National Naval Aviation Museum Foundation in Pensacola, Florida. Captain George B. Wilson, Commanding Officer, USS Alabama, will be played by Lieutenant Commander James E. Wilkie, United States Navy, Officer in Charge, Mobile Detachment for Commander, Naval Surface Group 6. Commander Neil K. Dietrich, First Executive Officer of the USS Alabama, will be portrayed by Lieutenant Commander Michael R. Schesser, United States Navy, Supply Officer for Commander, Naval Service Group 6. Commander G.L. Markle, first of USS Alabama's chaplains, will be played by Commander William Bennett, United States Navy, Group Chaplain, Marine Aircraft Group 26, 2nd Marine Aircraft Wing, Atlantic Marine Corps Air Station, New River, Jacksonville, North Carolina. Chief Warrant Officer H.H. Milan, USS Alabama's original bosun's mate, will be portrayed by Senior Chief Bosun's Mate Harry L. Hall, United States Navy, Deck Aviation Representative for Commander Naval Surface Group 6. One of USS Alabama's buglers will be portrayed by musician Second Class James Malmgren from the Navy Band, New Orleans, Louisiana.
Ship's company. And hut! Sir, ship's company is on board.
Sir, we're ready to proceed with the commissioning. Chaplain, proceed with the invocation.
Ship's company, parade, rest.
Let us pray. Eternal God, for as long as men have gone to the sea in ships, they have felt the awesome urging and mystery which takes them away from their loved ones. For as long as men have known that life lived only for oneself leads to adversity, they have taken up arms for lives more precious than their own. This magnificent ship brings together the sailors' dedication to successfully sail the unobstructed seas in peaceful missions. As the Alabama is placed in commission to take her place in our nation's Navy, we pray that those who have contributed to her planning and construction may never have cause for shame, that the great state for which she is named may be properly honored by her outstanding service, that those who sail her may devote themselves to the accomplishment of their every task. May our nation look to her with pride as a model of excellence. May she be respected, a respected adversary in conflict, an efficient deterrent to war, and a symbol of our commitment to world peace. We celebrate this glorious day with deep gratitude. May we ever draw our strength and support from you, whose perfect love is our peace, and whose peace is our power. Amen.
Ship's company. And hut!
In accordance with Chief of Naval Operations message, date time group 282100 Zebra, July 1942, when USS Alabama, BB-60, is in all respects ready, on or about 16 August 1942, place the ship in commission and direct the commanding officer to report to Commander Battle Force U.S. Atlantic Fleet. As authorized by the Secretary of the Navy and for the President of the United States, I hereby place United States ship Alabama in commission. God bless and Godspeed to all who sail in her.
Yes, please rise. Band, sound off.
Thank you.
captain. USS Alabama is in place in the commission.
Very well. I will read my orders. Bureau of Naval Personnel Orders 002119 from Chief of Naval Personnel to Captain George B. Wilson, United States Navy. Upon commissioning the USS Alabama, BB-60, accept command and report to Commander Battle Force, U.S. Atlantic Fleet. Sir, I accept command from USS Alabama.
Ship's company, attend. Break the Admiral's flag, sound off.
Admiral and distinguished guests, thank you for your presence here today. The ship's company and I appreciate the contributions you have made in preparing this ship for this moment. It is an honor to assume the command of Alabama, one of the most powerful battle wagons in the world. Her sister ships have already begun to avenge Pearl Harbor, and Alabama will soon be called upon to do the same. Be assured we will live up to the Alabama state motto by daring to defend our rights on the high seas. We are confident of victory. Executive officer, set the watch.
Aye, sir. Close to me. Set the watch. First section.
Alabama. First watch on set.
Very well. Captain, the watch has been set.
Very well. Secure from the commission ceremony.
This reenactment is concluded.
There's a term that goes with the U.S. Navy called plank owner. It relates back to the old sailing days when a guy served so many years aboard a ship, and then when he departed that ship, they didn't throw a party for him like we do nowadays. They gave him a piece of the deck. And that term has come down for many years, and in our Navy nowadays, those members of a crew of a vessel, when it is placed in commission, assigned to, picked up on the records, and physically aboard the ship on that day, are termed plank owner. On August the 15th, 1942, on this very site and in this very place, many of us stood here and listened to this reenactment ceremony. And I was so young back then, Captain, that I really didn't know what was going on, but I guarantee you it was impressive right now, and I'm ready to re-enlist if you're ready. We stood here and went through this ceremony, and it's an absolute great privilege for me to ask those people who are termed plank owners of this vessel, who stood here exactly 50 years ago, almost to the hour. The ship was commissioned at 1100 hours Eastern time, 1000 hours our time, but on a Sunday morning, August the 15th, 1942. Here we are, Sunday morning, August the 15th, 1942, 10 o'clock almost. And we're right on time, and I would like for all the plank owners to stand up and be recognized. Please do.
A ship really does have a soul. And you say, you mean the composite of the souls of all the people who serve in her. Well, that too, but no, I mean a ship has a soul of her own. And Alabama has a soul. And she knows she's happy here in the mud with all of us here attending this very, very significant ceremony.
Who are the Alabama crew members that we have come to remember this day? Their names cover the alphabet from Adams to Zaire. And they are the men who lined the decks of this ship for her christening and commissioning in 1942. They are the men who sailed into harm's way to protect convoys while attached to the British home fleet. The men who took Alabama to the Pacific in 1943 and saw action in the Gilbert Islands, Kwajalein, and Majuro. The men who were saddened by an accident at Mount 55, which left 5 dead and 11 injured. The men who jumped for joy when Alabama shot down her first enemy plane in a battle of the Philippine Sea and supported operations in the Marianas and in the Battle of Leyte Gulf. The men who were part of the overhaul at Puget Sound Naval Shipyard in early 1945. The men who, in May of 1945, destroyed 2 of the 5 suicide planes trying to attack the aircraft carrier Enterprise. The same men who went to general quarters at 2000 on a foggy 17 July 1945 for radar-directed shore bombardment of the Hitachi industrial plants on the island of Honshu in Japan. The same men who craned their necks to get a good look at Admiral Badger when he transferred his flag to the Alabama in August of 1945. And the men who lowered Alabama's colors for the very last time and left her decks silent when she was decommissioned in 1947. For together, you and your shipmates came face to face with the enemy. America is indebted to those who have served on the USS Alabama for their loyal service, their untold sacrifices, and for their contribution to world peace. It is an honor to be able to honor Alabama's crew and to remember those crew members who have died during the past 50 years. May God's richest blessings be upon you.
We have a gentleman and his wife who just came aboard after most of us were seated. We would be remiss if we did not recognize this individual who was a member of our crew and served on this ship some 3 years. I think he served in the 10th Division. But for people with a little gray around their temple who remember this guy as Rapid Robert Feller, the best pitcher that ever came down anybody's league, Bob, you may stand up. Leo Goulet, who all of you know, most of you anyway, all your crewmen know, will cast a rose into the waters of Mobile Bay in memory of those men in that division who are now deceased. And at this time, we would like to start this program by remembering those men in the 1st Division. Please stand. Be seated. 2nd Division. 2nd Division, please stand. 3rd Division. 4th Division, Marines. 5th Division. 6th Division. 7th Division, 8th Division, 9th Division, 10th Division, 5th Division, 5th Division, I Division, V Division,
10 Division. E Division. H Division. S Division. A Division. PA Division. PF Division. CS Division. CY Division. L Division. R Division. EX Division. And last, the W Division.
Help us, O Lord, as we pray, to make a daily exercise of faith and knowledge, raise our thoughts, purify our aspirations, strengthen us to resist wrong, and help us to serve for excellence. In your holy name I pray. Amen.